around the world, we are seeing an intensification of extreme weather events. Storms hit various parts of China on Sunday, affecting travel and destroying infrastructure. In Nanping City in China's Fujian province, a rainstorm broke meteorological records with strong gales at the speed of over 93 kilometers per hour, the fastest wind speed detected since a monitoring station was established in 1957. Europe has been experiencing extreme cold. The so-called beast from the east has been linked to Arctic warming, which causes the northern polar jet stream to leak cold air southward. Shocking images of thousands of dead starfish washed up on an English beach has been dubbed Starfish Armageddon. The UK's Marine Conservation Society said it was due to the extreme cold and the depth at which the storm waves had penetrated. Stateside, the deadly winter storm Riley battered the East Coast, flooding coastal areas. At least 9 people were killed, and 2.4 million homes and businesses had no power in the Northeast and Midwest. In Massachusetts, the storm surges and high tides sent seawater into streets, and the 90 miles per hour winds downed trees and power lines. In Washington, D.C., trees damaged homes and blocked streets. The storm also dumped as much as 18 inches of snow on parts of New York and Pennsylvania. The U.S. National Weather Service predicts another powerful East Coast storm midweek, with heavy snow, gusty winds, and coastal flooding, as well as a storm system across the central U.S., bringing heavy snow and blizzard conditions to the northern plains and upper Midwest.
Is called bombogenesis.
The term bomb cyclone.
Bombogenesis, when a storm bombs out.
While TV weather reports discuss bomb cyclones and bombogenesis, what is not being talked about is the link between this extreme weather and anthropogenic climate change, known to be caused primarily by the burning of fossil fuels.
The fact that there is climate change, the oceans are warmer, the sea surface temperatures are higher, the air above the oceans is warmer and moister than it used to be, and the environment in which all of these storms are occurring is simply different than it used to be. And this adds to the rainfalls in particular, it adds to the activity in a general sense, and that activity is usually manifest in the forms of more intense, larger, and longer-lived storms.
As well as the much-needed action on climate change mitigation, could better disaster preparedness not only save lives, but also save money?
Why are we measuring our effectiveness in disasters based on dollars spent and lives lost? And when instead it should be, it's a much greater cost savings to invest in preparedness ahead of time. It's a much greater cost savings to invest in mitigation. So the short-term disaster response, we're seeing a lot of acknowledgement of the importance of this, but long-term in terms of the larger mechanisms that maybe cost a little bit more money in the short run, but aren't experienced the savings until the longer run, we're actually reversing the steps that were taken in the last administration, which is just going to put us that much farther behind. The federal government should be doing is really looking at the future impacts of climate change. What are these long-term tools that are in place to help really sort of guide things towards more resilient infrastructure?
This is Kathleen Maitland-Carter reporting for The Real News.